Okay?
Yeah, let's start, yes.
Good afternoon, and it's a pleasure to introduce Pere Mujal. Pere Mujal got his PhD last year in physics at the University of Barcelona under the supervision of Professor Artur Pols, that recently passed away, and Professor Bruno Giulia Diaz. His work was on interacting ultracold few-boson systems and was funded by a fellowship from Generalitat de Catalunya. He has been also working in a project on neural network to describe the ground states of ultracold systems in presence of disorder. And just 1 month and 10 days ago, he joined us, funded by the project of the CAIB on quantum reservoir computing. And today, so welcome, Pere. And thank today you. Is going to present his work on localization and spin orbit coupling in interacting few boson systems. So please share your screen, and we are ready to learn.
Okay, I think this is working.
Yes, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Roberta, for the nice introduction. So today I will present this work that is a part of my PhD thesis that I did in collaboration with Artur and Bruno, my PhD supervisors, and also in collaboration with Sebastiano Pilati, who is from the University of Camerino in Italy. So first of all, I have here an outline of this talk. I will start with a general description of the formalism and the method that we use to study our systems. And in order to give you an idea what we did in practice. And then I will discuss and introduce you to these two topics. And that are two different systems that we studied using our approach, which is exact diagonalization. And both systems, apart from the fact that we use the same technique for the study, we study these systems because we are interested in knowing how are the effects of the interactions in the systems, in particular the effect of repulsive interactions, when at the single particle level there are other effects. For instance, in the first case, there's the effect of Anderson localization in the single particle system, and then we add repulsive interactions to the system. And in the second case, we have a system with a spin orbit coupling. And we also want to see what happens if we include the repulsive interactions with between the particles in this system. So, and finally, I will have the conclusions and summary. So let me start with the methodology. The most general case that we consider is a system of atoms. In our context, we consider ultracold atoms. So atoms in a quantum regime that are at zero temperature. So we don't consider temperature effects. So the temperature is fixed at T equals zero, absolute zero. And we describe our system in the general case by using this general Hamiltonian. So this is the energy of the system. This Hamiltonian has two different parts in general. One part that is the single particle part or the non-interacting part of the Hamiltonian, and another part that is the interaction part of the Hamiltonian. That, as you can see here, in the most general case, we consider two-body interactions between M particles. In the systems that I will present in the next part of this talk, we have one case with a one-dimensional system and another case with a two-dimensional system. In the one-dimensional case, that is the case with the Anderson localization, in order to model the interaction between our particles, we use a contact delta potential. So the potential that we consider for the interaction between the particles is this potential here that models the interaction between the particles. Considering that the interaction is a contact through this delta, and this G parameter in front of this delta is the interaction strength. So characterizes the interaction strength. And in this one-dimensional case, and for this potential, the G parameter can be related to the 1D scattering length this G can be related to the 1D scattering length of this potential, that is this A naught here. This is important because in the experimental setups, in experiments with ultracold atoms, what is the experimental parameter that they control is this A naught, the scattering length of the system. And in the two-dimensional case, the model potential that we consider for the interactions between our particles is this Gaussian potential that is characterized by two parameters. One is, again, this G parameter, that is interaction strength between the particles, and another parameter that is this S parameter, that is the interaction range. So if we take this S going to the limit of tending to zero, we would recover contact potential. And again, we can relate for this Gaussian potential, these parameters, to the two-dimensional scattering length of the system. So in general, what we want to do is to find the properties of the eigenstates of this Hamiltonian, of the general Hamiltonian for these two different systems. So what we want is to find a way to diagonalize the Hamiltonian matrix of the system and have the energy spectrum of this Hamiltonian. So that means solving the time-independent Schrödinger equation for the system of n particles. In general, this is not an easy task, but for some in some cases, this can be done with exact diagonalization. So in particular, if you have a few particles. And as a curiosity, it's in this paper here by Thomas Wuch and others, they found a way to solve the Schrödinger equation for interacting, for two particles interacting in harmonic potential. So in general, this is not an easy task, but in some cases, even an interacting system can be, the Schrödinger equation can be solved analytically. Okay, in our case, we use a numerical approach. So what we do is to translate the Hamiltonian in the first quantized form to a second quantized Hamiltonian. So again, we have the total Hamiltonian that has a non-interacting part and an interaction part. And here we write each part of the Hamiltonian in a proper way to work in this second quantized way. For the single particle part, what we do is to so the form of the single particle Hamiltonian, so I call it single particle, but in fact this Hamiltonian acts on the Hilbert space of n particles, but this Hamiltonian considers all single particle effects in the system. So this is the form of this part of the Hamiltonian, in which we have this creation and annihilation operators, the creation operator with the dagger and the annihilation operator here, that create and destroy particles in the single particle states of the system that we have chosen as a basis for our single particle system. So we have these operators here and these numbers here that are these coefficients that come from the single particle Hamiltonian. So this ket here is our an element of our single particle basis. We compute these numbers, and with these numbers we can construct the single particle part of our second quantized Hamiltonian. And in a similar way, once we have our single particle basis, we can compute these numbers here, these coefficients, given two-body interaction potential. So we have these numbers and these creation and annihilation operators in order to construct our interacting part of the Hamiltonian. So I have to say that, in fact, we want to solve the Schrödinger equation for an infinite dimensional system. However, as a way to approximate our the solutions, so that in order to find the energy spectrum of this infinite Hilbert space, we truncate the Hilbert space at the single particle level, because we use a finite single particle basis. So this M here is the number of elements of our single particle basis. And our method, the diagonalization of the Hamiltonian, we know that converges to the exact energies of the system when we increase the dimension of our reduced Hilbert space. So when we increase the number of single particle basis states, for instance. Once we have our single particle basis states, we construct the many body states in order to have a basis of our many body Hilbert space. So our basis states for our many body Hilbert space are Fock states. So we just create particles to the vacuum state, and we have these Fock states in which each quantum number is the number of atoms that populate each single particle basis state. And in order to improve our calculations, we construct the many body Hilbert space in a way to avoid having a large matrix. So let me illustrate this. So here again, we have the M-boson Fock states defined as this way. So creating particles into the vacuum state. One thing that is important is that our number of atoms is fixed. So the sum of the over all these quantum numbers of a Fock state give the total number of particles of our system. And to give you an example, here I have the case of a two-dimensional harmonic oscillator. Here in red, we have the single particle eigenstates of this oscillator. So here I represent the energies of the single particle system for a two-dimensional harmonic oscillator. So the energies are given by this equation here. So this is and the two quantum numbers for each direction, nx and ny, plus one, because there's a constant term of 1/2 for each spatial direction that gives this one. So these are energy states, x spaced, one energy unit in units of harmonic oscillator energy, and they are also degenerate. And for instance, this Fox state that I write here is the one with all the bosons in the ground state of the single particle system. So we have n bosons populating the ground state of the two-dimensional harmonic oscillator. So this n here means that we have n particles in this first single particle mode, and zero particles in the other single particle modes or single particle eigenstates. And another example that is given here is this other state represented here, in which we have all particles in the ground, in the single particle ground state, but one particle promoted to one of the first excited states of this system. So in this second quantized formalism, our many body basis states are these Fox states that the quantum numbers are only the number of bosons populating each single particle state of our single particle basis. Okay. So once we have a many body basis, we can construct the Hamiltonian matrix of our system. So once we have our Hamiltonian and a basis, we can represent our system, so our Hamiltonian, with a matrix. And our goal is to diagonalize that matrix and to find the eigenstates of that matrix, because the eigenstates of the Hamiltonian are the energies, eigenenergies of our system, so the energy spectrum. This is something that is not easy in the general case of n particles, and when you consider m single particle basis states, because the dimension of the m boson Hilbert space is given by this number here for the case of bosons. That is the case that we consider. So if we are interested in increasing n, because we are interested in knowing how is the system for different number of particles, we have a problem, because the dimension of our matrix increases very rapidly. And we have an additional problem is that our method is a variational but an approximate method, and we reach convergence when we increase the number of single particle states considered. So when we increase the dimension of our Hilbert space, and this is achieved by increasing n. So in practice, we have large matrices that we want to diagonalize. To give you some examples, if we only consider two particles, the dimension of the Hilbert space is this one given here. So for 200 single particle basis states, the two boson Hilbert space is this 20,000. So we are limited by this fact that we have to diagonalize a very large matrix. So we can limit ourselves to a small number of particles, or increase the number of particles but use less states to describe our system. A way to face this problem is to establish an energy criterion to cut the Fock space. So instead of using all Fock states, once you have fixed the number of single particle states and the number of bosons, instead of considering this size, so the whole Fock space, we can restrict ourselves in the Fock states that have an energy less or equal than a given maximum energy. So for each state of our many body basis, we can define this energy that is given for the non-interacting part of the Hamiltonian. It's just the non-interacting energy for that state of our basis. And then we consider only the Fock states that accomplish this energy criterion. And that relates the truncation of our many body Hilbert space to the single particle basis. So it relates the truncation at the single particle level or of our single particle basis to the truncation of our many body Hilbert space. And not only that, but also it reduces the size of our Hilbert space. So it reduces the size of our matrix that we want to diagonalize. To give you an example, again, with a two-dimensional harmonic oscillator for M bosons. Here in this table, you have the M, so the number of bases of for your single particle system. So this one means that you are only considering the first single particle state. This three means that you are considering this the ground state and the two first excited states. This six means that you are considering these states here. And if you construct the whole Fock space in each of these cases for four particles, the dimension is given by these numbers here in this last call. However, if you fix a maximum energy for your Fock states, then the dimension of your Hilbert space, so the dimension of your matrix, can be reduced. So you can achieve also a good convergence of your calculations, increasing the dimension of your Hilbert space, but you don't need these huge matrices that you were using in the previous case. So the intuition behind this idea is that if you want to describe a system of many particles and you want to study the low energy states of your system, you don't need to consider states with a lot of excited particles, like in this example here, but it's better to consider more single particle modes and less excited particles. So it's better to consider this state represented here rather than this state here, because this state here, the one on the right, is a state with a lot of energy. You have a lot of particles in your first excited state. So the energy of this state is the number of particles that you have here multiplied by the energy of this first excited state. However, this state here is a state with less energy, because most of the particles are in the single particle ground state, and you have only one excited particle. So basically this is the idea so that we use to diagonalize the Hamiltonian matrices for the systems that I will present you in the following parts of the talk. So I will start with the phenomenon of Anderson localization. As I said, I will explain how the interactions are considered in a system that has Anderson localization at the single particle level. First of all, let me introduce the phenomenon of Anderson localization to you. In our case, we consider Anderson localization in bose-Einstein condensates, so in ultra-cold atoms. But Anderson localization is a phenomenon that can be present in any kind of waves. So this is a wave phenomenon. In this case here, this is Anderson localization in an ultra-cold atom experiment. So these two groups did this kind of experiment for the first time in 2008. And what they did is they had a cloud of atoms, so a wave packet of non-interacting bosons, and they put that bosons in the center of the system, that is a one-dimensional system because the atoms are only allowed to move through this waveguide that is created with a laser beam. So you have a one-dimensional system, you have your initially your atoms at the center of your system, and you shine your atoms with an additional laser that passes through this diffusing plate. And what this laser passing through this diffusion plate is creating is an external potential to these atoms that is a disordered potential. And what they observe is that when they prepare all the atoms at the center of the system and then let the system evolve, if there's disorder, so if there's this external potential that introduces disorder in the system, then the atoms remain localized in the center of the system and they don't spread through the system. So when there's disorder, if you prepare the atoms at the center of the system and you let the system evolve in time, the atoms remain localized at the position where you prepare it. If there's no disorder in the system, when you let the atoms at the center of the trap and let it evolve the wave function in time, the wave function expands. So there's transport of matter through the system. However, when there's disorder, there's this phenomenon of Anderson localization, and due to the presence of this disorder that here is created through the external potential, the particles remain localized in the center of the system. So this is the Anderson localization phenomenon in this ultra-cold atom experiments. So this is a single particle effect, and what we want to see is what happens if we consider this system and we add repulsive interactions between the atoms. So in order to see if this localization remains or what happens. So in order to study that experimental systems, here we consider our model. And the potential that introduces disorder is the external potential that is a speckle potential. A speckle potential is a potential like this one here. So here we have our external potential in space, and we simulate, we do our calculations inside a hard wall box. So we have our one-dimensional system in this one-dimensional box, with an external potential, this is one here, and we have atoms. In this case, a single atom. This external potential is characterized by a speckle correlation length, that is the length, the space between two consecutive peaks here, and is also, this potential is also characterized by the mean value of the intensity of the potential. So these are the two parameters that characterize a speckle potential. And for this particular case here, we have these values of the potential, and the value of the potential in each point of the space is generated randomly, generating random numbers with a particular distribution. So this is a particular case of a speckle potential. And here I want to show you the wave functions, the eigenfunctions of this particular speckle potential. So this is the single particle case. So in the top panels, we have the wave functions the eigenstates of this speckle potential. As you can see here, this one is the corresponds to the ground state of the system, and this wave function is localized in this area in this interval in space, and you can see that the other eigenstates of the system are localized in space. Here I represent the wave function, but yeah, the modulus square of the wave function is the density. So you can see here that the eigenstates of the system are localized in space. Not only the low energy states, but also higher energy states. Okay. In order to see if our system is localized or not, we use a technique that is to study the energy spectrum of the system. So before, here I show you that the eigenfunctions are localized in space, so you can see that are localized in a region in space, but in the more general case, for instance, if we want to consider more particles, we need a different criterion to discern between a localized situation from a delocalized situation. So what we do is to find the energy spectrum of the system, so we use our deionization technique to find the energies corresponding to the Hamiltonian matrix. Then we select an energy window and we compute these R values that are the ratios between consecutive gaps of the energy spectrum. So with the eigenenergies of the system, we are able to compute these R values, and we do this for energy windows. So we divide our spectrum in groups of energy windows, and we compute mean values over these energy windows, and we repeat this for many different spectral potentials. So we generate many different spectral potentials with different values in each point of space, and then we compute the mean value of R in each energy window. And this this value here determines if the system is localized or if the system is delocalized. So with the case of localization given by the mean value of R here, that corresponds to a Poisson distribution of the spacings of the gaps, and if the system is delocalized, we have this other value here that corresponds to Wigner-Dyson distribution of the spacings. So this Wigner-Dyson value comes from a random matrix theory. So if you generate a random matrix and do this procedure, then you will find this value, this 0.53 value. However, if there is localization, it means that our matrix is not a random matrix, so there's something different. And in the case of a localization, we get this 0.38 value. So computing this value, we can discern between the two situations. At the single particle level, what we did first is to compute the mean value of R for different energy values. So for instance, here in the left part of the x-axis, there are the energies of the ground state of the system for different spectral potentials. And higher energy states are in the right part of the x-axis. So depending on the size of our system, so our simulation is done in a finite box of size L, we observe localization in the whole energy range, or we observe a transition from a localized to a delocalized system. But this is an effect due to our finite size system. So before studying the effect of interactions, we have to set the size of our system big enough in order to find our system localized and not forget about the finite size of our system. And we have also to consider the spectral intensity in order to have, again, Anderson localization at the single particle level. So we have to be careful with the size of our box and with the intensity of the spectral potential in order to have Anderson localization in the single particle case. Because we want to see if when we include repulsive interactions, there's delocalization in the system. So we start with a system that at the single particle level is localized, and we want to see if the repulsive interactions break this localization. So here they are the results for 2 and 3 bosons in the same system. Again, we compute this mean value of R. The localization value is represented with this discontinuous red line in each panel. In the left, you have the n equal to case, in the right, the n equal to 3 case, so the two boson and 3 boson systems. And again, we have the mean value of R depending on the energy. So again, in the left part, we have the ground state energies of our speckles, and in the right part, the excited state energies. And from top to bottom, we increase the repulsion between the atoms. So in the top panel, we have a system of 2 bosons without interactions, and we reproduce the Poisson value. So when the system at the single particle level is localized, if you put another particle and there are no interactions between the particles, the system remains localized. However, if we increase the interaction strength, so this G positive means that this is repulsive, we observe that the system also remains localized. So even in the case when we have a strong and repulsive interaction strength, the system remains localized. So we also find this Poissonian value for the mean value of R. So what we see here is that when the system is Anderson localized, even in the case in which you include repulsive interactions, the system remains localized, and these repulsive interactions do not destroy the localization in the system. In order to see if we were choosing our G values, so the values of the interaction strength properly, we compared the mean value of the ground state energy of our systems with the strongly interacting limit. So we can see how close we are to the strongly interacting limit in that system. Because it is well known that at the non-interacting limit, there's Anderson localization, and in the strongly interacting limit, there's also Anderson localization. So we wanted to explore the region in between, because the two limits are well known. In one limit, in both limits, there's Anderson localization, but we wanted to see if there's delocalization in between due to the presence of a repulsive interaction. And we have seen that in this intermediate regime, there's no, this transition is not present. So the system remains localized in any case. So this is all that I wanted to tell you about this system. And now let's move to the other topic. So now we move from one dimension to two dimensions, and here the single particle effect that is involved in our problem is spin orbit coupling. And again, we want to see what happens when we include repulsive interactions in this system. Why are we interested in installing a spin orbit coupling in this kind of system? Because in ultra-cold atom experiments, there's a lot of control over several experimental parameters. for instance, they can control the value of the interaction strength. So in the previous case, this the value of G experimentally can be tuned. Moreover, they have a great control on the external potential, and they can image the system in a very controlled way. Even they can in these ultra cold atom experiments, they can image single atoms and control how single atoms move. So these experiments are a very good candidate platforms for quantum simulation. And in particular, for the case of spin-orbit coupling, the first time spin-orbit coupling was observed in ultra-cold experiments was in 2011 in this group. So the goal of these experiments is to have a quantum system that mimics the behavior, for instance, of electrons moving through material, but with crucial differences that are when electrons move in a material, you are not able to see each electron individually or to tune the interaction between electrons or these kind of things. However, in these ultra-cold atom experiments, they are able to do that. So in this case, for the spin-orbit coupling, they used rubidium, bose-Einstein condensate, and the spin degree of freedom in this case is not the intrinsic spin of the atoms, but is a pseudo-spin degree of freedom. So the up and down here corresponds to internal states of these atoms. And in this case here, the kind of terms that they could simulate, so engineer, are terms like this one here. So you have the spin-orbit coupling here is between the linear momentum and this spin degree of freedom. So in other words, if a particle has a non-zero momentum, then this Pauli matrix flips the spin. So spin down goes to spin up, and spin up goes to spin down. So this spin-orbit coupling acts in this way. So flipping the spin depending on the linear momentum. And this is something that I have said before. We want to see what happens if we have this kind of terms and also interaction between the particles. So let's start first with a single particle system. So the Hamiltonian of our single particle system is this one given here. So we have harmonic potential. That is this term, this first term in the Hamiltonian. Then we have a kinetic energy. This is a constant term. And the last term is the spin orbit coupling term. In our case, we study this term that is given here, that is of Rajba type, because this the form that has this spin orbit coupling term here is of Rajba type. This is the name. And here in this plot, I have the energy spectrum of this Hamiltonian depending on the value of kappa. This kappa here is the spin-orbit coupling strength. So if we start at kappa equal to zero, these terms are not here, and we have a two-dimensional harmonic oscillator. So we have at kappa equal to zero, the eigen energy is given by 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is our harmonic oscillator energies in two dimensions. For instance, this one here is one half corresponding to the x direction, plus 1/2 coming from the y direction. And as we are in 2D, we have also degeneracy, and the degeneracy of each level here, of each energy, is given by this expression. However, when we increase kappa, we observe that the degeneracy is broken, and that the energy levels split in several energy levels. And at least, due to time reversal symmetry of this Hamiltonian, we know that each line here, so each energy level here, is twofold degenerate. So each line here corresponds to two eigenstates of the Hamiltonian. And interestingly, when we increase kappa a lot at the large kappa limit, we also find these manifolds that are X-spaced. Again, like the in the limit of zero of kappa equal to zero. So there's this manifold formation in this large kappa limit. So a lot of energy levels become degenerate, and for instance, in this first manifold, you can see that a lot of energy levels that before were high energy states go down when you increase kappa, and then they quasi degenerate and form the first manifold. So this is the effect of the presence of this spin-orbit coupling term in the system. In order to understand what is happening here, you have to consider the total angular momentum. And so in this case, the total angular momentum, this J, is the sum of the spin plus the orbital angular momentum. And you can approximate the behavior in the large kappa limit by this expression given here. And you can see that each manifold is characterized by this n quantum number. This is a radial quantum number plus 1/2. So it seems like the energy in the large kappa limit is like a 1D harmonic oscillator. So this n that has values 0, 1, 2, and plus 1/2, and each n characterizing a manifold. For instance, here in this figure, that is a zoom of the previous figure, this n equal to 0 corresponds to the states that are here in red. And if you increase this n quantum number, then you have states that are in the next manifold. So here, for instance, are represented in blue. And within each manifold, what distinguishes between each state is the Z component of the total angular momentum. That is the other quantum number that characterizes the energy of these states. So the JZ increases from bottom to top in this figure. And the twofold degeneracy of each energy level in the system is seen here due to the fact that the energy depends on JZ squared. So the two possible signs of JZ give the same energy. So up to this point, this is the single particle system. So this is the effect of a spin-orbit coupling in this two-dimensional harmonic oscillator. And now let's move to the two-particle system. The easiest thing is to consider the non-interacting case. So here in this top panel, we have the low energy part of the system, and again, depending on this kappa. And this, the energies of the system are only the sums of the single particle energies. So the ground state of the system here is this one here, And in order to obtain this this spectrum, you only have to, the only thing you have to do is to sum the single particle energies, depending on kappa, and you can construct this energy spectrum. However, if we want to include the effect of repulsive interactions in the system, then we have to diagonalize the Hamiltonian matrix for the two boson system in the repulsively interacting case. Here in this bottom plot, we have again the low energy part of the spectrum, but here we have this G equal to 3. So we have two bosons with a strong repulsive interactions. And again, at kappa equal to 0, we don't have spin orbit coupling, and the spin orbit coupling effects are more notorious when kappa is large. And what we see here is that, again, it is important to consider the total angular momentum. So in the non-interacting case, the ground, in particular, if we focus on the ground state of the system, before, without interactions, we have a ground state that is threefold degenerate, with one state with jz equal to 0, and two states with the absolute value of jz equal to 1. One with plus 1, and the other one with minus 1. And these three eigenstates remain degenerate independently of the value of kappa. However, if we have repulsive interactions in the system, we observe that at some point the degeneracy is clearly broken between the state with jz equal to 0 and the other two states. And then in this point here, there's a high energy state that crosses the ground state of the system. And in particular, this energy level that here is in green is characterized by the fact that the JZ is no longer zero, but it's equal to plus or minus 3. So here the degeneracy of the ground state is equal to 1. Here we have a direct crossing in the spectrum, and the ground state becomes twofold degenerate energy level characterized by the absolute value of JZ equal to 3. Here, this is clear in the energy spectrum, but we wanted to see if this transition from JZ equal to 0, from the absolute value of JZ equal to 3, can be seen in other physical quantities. For instance, in the energy contributions to the ground state. In the top panel, we have again the non-interacting case, and in the bottom panel, we have the strong interacting case. In the top panel, we observe that all energy contributions are continuous. However, in the bottom panel, we see that due to the presence of the direct crossing, there's a discontinuity in the energy contributions to the ground state energy. So the ground state energy here is the one in purple, and the other energy terms, the harmonic potential, the kinetic energy, spin orbit energy terms, are in the other colors. And in all of those energy contributions to the ground state energy, we observe a discontinuity. And we also checked that the contributions to the ground state energy fulfill the virial theorem energy relation. So we ensured that our numerical calculations were okay in this sense. And for the last thing that I wanted to show you for this system is that the effect of the interactions in this spin orbit coupled system could also be observed in the total density of the system, or spin projected densities. But here, if we focus on the total density, these are these two panels here. Before the crossing, the density has a maximum peak at the center of the trap. And in the case after the crossing, when the ground state of the system is characterized by this JZ equal to plus or minus 3, we have a minimum at the center of the trap. So the effects of interactions in this spinor recoupling system could also be seen in the total density of the system. And with that, I finish this talk. There are the conclusions. So in the first system, the one-dimensional system, we have seen that analyzing the energy spectrum of the system, we can discern between the localized and delocalized situation. This is something that we can do because we have diagonalized the Hamiltonian matrix, so we have access to not only the ground state but also the low energy state of the system. And we have observed that the localization is robust against repulsive interactions in this system. So these are the main conclusions of the first part. And in the second part, we have seen that the spinor recoupling has as a single particle effect the formation of manifolds in the energy spectrum. But when we have a two-body system with repulsive interactions, these manifolds, the degeneracy in these manifolds is broken, and there are energy level crossings. And in particular, in the ground state of the system, there is a direct crossing between the state of JZ equal to zero to a state with JZ equal to plus and minus 3. And we have observed that this crossing in the ground state could be observed in the, for instance, in other quantity, in physical quantities like energy, discontinuity in the energy contributions, and a sudden change in the density profile of the system. So, and with that, I finish. And if you have any questions, I'm here available.
Thank you, Pere.
Thank you.
So are there any questions? If not, I can start. So you have a hand, your hands. Just enter my room.
Yeah, well, I had to, well, first of all, thank you for the talk. I had two questions or comments. One is for the spin orbit coupling. Normally, spin orbit coupling, you have in charged particles. But if I understood well, the bosons are not charged. Is it correct?
Yes, it's correct.
So is it like a synthetic spin orbit or like a...
Yes, it's a synthetic spin orbit. Mm-hmm. Yes, this is a difference. Apart from the fact that the spin here refers to internal states of the atoms, it's also true that the spin orbit coupling here is a synthetic spin orbit coupling.
Mm-hmm. And it can be controlled, the intensity can be controlled in the range, in these ranges you have shown.
Yes. So the value of kappa is fixed with the field, the laser field that creates the spin orbit coupling synthetically.
I also had a comment on the localization. You have been using exact diagonalization, but have you considered also other approximate methods like random phase approximation or other methods to describe collective states, or these other methods are not appropriate for your problem?
I didn't consider other methods, but so in previous works, other approaches were used to study these effects. But for instance, they used mean field approaches. However, if you use mean field, you are not considering a strongly correlated
sure.
states. Mm-hmm. So here our focus was on the fact that we wanted to see if these strongly correlations due to repulsive interactions could have an effect on the localization.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
And I have also a question.
Please.
C- Can you hear me?
Yes.
Ah, yeah. It's about also about the localization. And I wonder, the form of the interaction can change your conclusion? Because your conclusion was that the interaction of bosons does not change the localization. But if the interaction was a long-range interaction type, then can the conclusion can be changed, or how do you think?
Yes, that's a very interesting point. So in our case, we used a contact interaction. So our conclusion is only valid for a contact interaction, and it's also true that it's only valid for the two particle and three particle systems. So one possible thing that one could look at is what happens when you increase the number of particles. So this is something that is that we cannot do, and with this technique. And another thing is to change the interaction and to consider a long range interaction. In that case, what I have said here is not true, or I don't know. So it's something that one should look.
Yeah. And regarding to that, in the experimental situation of the cold atoms, can you control the type of interaction somehow? Because you are assuming some specific type of interaction rather than some kind of Coulomb repulsion. So I wonder, is there a way to control the interaction in experiments, or it's just for theoretical study, or?
Up to my knowledge, in these experiments that I showed you, the interactions are very well described by a contact interaction, because they consider these atoms in a very dilute regime. And if you want to consider long-range interactions, maybe you would need a different experimental setup. Instead of using these Bose-Einstein condensates, maybe you should use trapped ions or atoms in a lattice. So that in some way you can engineer a long range interaction. But in these Bose-Einstein experiments that I showed you, I think that interaction is a contact interaction, or is there's no interaction, or the interaction is contact interaction.
Okay. Yeah, thank you for the talk.
Are there further questions? I also have a small couple questions, but are there any other?
I have a question. Well, mine is just a semantic question. I know that this, in the system of two bosons in the trap with the spin orbit coupling, it's a system of two particles, but this transition by changing the parameter kappa from a ground state of zero angular momentum to a ground state of angular momentum 3 can be called a quantum phase transition, or has some of the properties of a quantum phase transition. Probably this is just semantics, but I want to know something about the semantics.
Yes. So I would not call it a phase transition, but the reason is what you said, because this is only a two particle system. But of course, this is a transition from two very different states that are characterized with a different quantum number. So.
Okay. I also wanted to ask if you, I mean, remaining consistent with your cutoff in the energy, if you have calculated some dynamics in the system beyond calculate again modes and so on, can you introduce some quench and remaining within this cutoff be able to describe some, for instance, like in the suggestive images you shown at the beginning, in which you really observe the effect of localization or this kind of thing? Can you do that numerically?
Yes, so this is something that I started to look at, but now it's not. So, yes, I can do what you said. So I can prepare the system in some state and then study quench dynamics with the speckle, and observe that how the system evolves in time. So, and in principle, what one expects to have the system localized. So to have the wave, for instance, if you look at the density of the system for the two particles or three particles, you would observe that the density profile maybe have some internal time evolution, but it remains in the same position. And you also, and another thing that also characterizes the localization, so Anderson localization, is the exponential decay of the tails of your of the wave function. So this is another thing that in the experiments they look at this thing to prove that there's Anderson localization. So yes.
Okay. Thank you. I think we can continue privately, people interested, and we can conclude here. We are a little bit late. So thank you very much for the nice presentation, and see you next week.
Thank you.
Bye.